بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم افتح علينا فتوح العارفين ووفقنا توفيق الصالحين وانفعنا اللهم بالقرآن والذكر الحكيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The intention of today's talk, the title being the legacy of Sayyiduna Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala an, a man ahead of his time. And I don't intend to speak about his life per se. What were his feats and what he performed, what was said about him by the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wassalam, or other notable companions. But rather I want to speak about what he left for this ummah. And my intention today is that when we leave from this gathering, you will feel honored to be a Muslim. Nothing more than a Muslim. That we have come from such a man. Our ummah has held such a man, the like of whom history has not seen. A conqueror. And sometimes this word is used in a very negative connotation. But when you look at the conquests of Sayyiduna Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala an, you will know what chivalry means. You will know what it means to be honest and just and fair. What it means to be brave and courageous. And all these words that we sometimes hear and say and speak, but we don't see them in practice. You see them in the life of Sayyiduna Umar ibn al-Khattab. You see them in the life of his khilafah. And I wouldn't be wrong to say that after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the peak of this ummah was his lifetime. The peak of this ummah, the ummah has never achieved anything like what they achieved during his lifetime. And if we can go back today inshallah, and Allah ta'ala giving life, realizing what it means to be one body as Muslims, and appreciating our leaders like Sayyiduna Umar ibn al-Khattab, I think we've achieved something inshallah as a Muslim nation. I will speak about some of his life that is relevant to his character in how he led the Khilafah. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wassalam, he said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَبِسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي. Hold on to my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided caliphs that will come after me. And the words of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam were so perfect. When we look at the sunan, the practices, the introductions of Sayyiduna Umar ibn al-Khattab, and the effect of them in the world we live in today, you'll be utterly amazed. Did a man like him exist? Was he able to achieve what he achieved in a very short period of 10 years? The aim being to speak about his khilafah more than his life. But the amount of information we have about him, about his khilafah, it is very easy for a speaker to divert and go off on tangents and miss the point. So before I continue, I'd like to know how long I've got to speak. I'm telling you, today could be like a 5-hour session. And I'm not joking, it is easy to speak for that long. Someone who's unaccomplished like me could speak on him for that long. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. He's from the tribe of Bani Adi. He's from the Quraysh, that was his family name, Bani Adi, and he's from the Quraysh. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, he was brought up in Makkah al-Mukarramah. And as a young boy, his father introduced him to shepherdship, in becoming a shepherd, in grazing camels. And this was seen as a notable job for young Arabs. But his father relentlessly made him work. And he would speak about it later in life when he passed by a particular hill and he gave a sigh and he said, I remember the days when I used to graze camels here. And when I would stop, my father would beat me and make me continue. And I would have no time to stop. But that made him develop into who he developed. And as he grew older and became mature, there were certain noble traits, virtues, that the Arabs looked up to. And if you possessed them, you were notable amongst the people. From them was public oration, being able to speak. From them was being an athlete or wrestling. And he was well known for this. There was a fair that would take place annually in the hills of Arafah by the name of Ukaz. The fair of Ukaz. It's a very famous fair. If you read the books of Sirah, you'll come familiar with this particular trade that would take place in this fair. Now people would come from all over Arabia and people would come to trade. But second to this, people would come to show their virtues, arts that they had mastered. So you'd find people like Hassan bin Thabit and Naghiba and other poets coming forth, and every poet presenting his poetry. And if you were victorious, as you may say, in this fair Ukaz, you were known all over the Arabian Peninsula. People would go back and say, do you know what happened this time? This particular poet, he won, and this is his poetry. It was like the national gathering of the Arabs. And from this was competitions in wrestling. And you'd only enter if you were a champion. You had mastered your art. Sayyiduna Umar ibn al-Khattab was accustomed to enter every year. It was a norm for him to enter, and it was a norm for him to win. He would win and win and win. There would be times that he wouldn't, but it was a norm. When people would come to Mecca, to this fair Ukaz, people knew who they were facing. There's a young blood in the valley of Mecca by the name of Umar ibn Khattab. He wasn't the only one. He wasn't the only one. There was another one. He was Khalid bin Walid, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. These two youth in Mecca were known to be the strongest of youth, and they would wrestle. And this was a character, a trait of the Arabs that they liked and looked up to. Sayyidina Umar would wrestle with Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid. At times Sayyidina Umar would win, and at times Sayyidina Khalid. A time came when Sayyidina Khalid grew in strength, and they wrestled, and he broke the leg of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab. They were relatives from different tribes, from the mother's side. But these are the kind of people we're speaking about. They would go into this fair to fight and wrestle. When we speak about him being an athlete, Umar ibn al-Khattab would jump onto horseback. He would literally jump onto horseback and be so firm on his seat, on the back of the horse, and it would seem to people that he was part and parcel of the horse. He was part of the horse. This is how strong this man was. But it wasn't only strength. It wasn't only strength. There was the sense of wisdom with this man. As he grew older, he started looking for a livelihood. And Arabs would turn to trade if they were intelligent, witty. And he turned to trade. And before Islam, before becoming a Muslim, Umar ibn al-Khattab, he traveled. He traveled a lot. And these trade travels developed his character. He visited and paid homage to famous personalities of the age. He became broad-minded. He developed in his experiences, in knowledge of people, of lands. And soon enough, people became familiar with this young man. In time, he grew in age, experience, and he became notable amongst the Arabs, particularly his own people. Particularly his own people, the Quraysh. Until each clan and tribe, the Quraysh was one of them, each clan would have an ambassador who they would place forward to speak on behalf of the whole tribe. We're talking about a clan in which the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam himself is existent. He himself is there. This is his time, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And this is a young youth. When Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab embraced Islam, he was no more than 27, they say. About 27. So we're talking about before Islamic days. He became notable. The Quraysh liked him so much that they gave him and invested him the position of being the ambassador of the Quraysh. So whenever Quraysh would have an argument, a deal, a contract, whatever it may be, anything of importance that the Quraysh had to deal with other clans or tribes, Umar ibn al-Khattab would be the representative. So you can imagine how he was considered amongst people. When the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam came forth with his message, being literate, being able to read and write, was an exceptional quality. At his time, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there were only 17 men. 17 men. 17 is a very small number. 17 men that were able to read and write. Umar ibn al-Khattab was one of these people. So you can imagine what kind of man he was. Now when we look at before him embracing Islam, imagine now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam making dua that, oh Allah, give victory to Islam, strengthen Islam, either by Abu Jahl or Umar ibn al-Khattab. It wasn't just merely a dua made by the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam. There were certain traits seen in this man. He was a man of influence before he became Muslim. And his whole life until the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam passed away is of great importance. Two of the famous or most notable incidents in his life during the lifetime of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam is his embracement to Islam, and secondly, the Hijrah, his migration. Of course, there are many other feats that I don't want to speak about, because if we speak about his life, I'm not going to speak about the topic, inshallah. He embraced Islam, and the incident is very famous and well known. But just to recollect about his life, his behavior, he was a firm man, and there's a world of difference between being harsh and being firm. He was a firm man. He was a man of principles. He stood his ground. And when he started hearing about the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he as a non-Muslim at that time disliked, that people were moving away from the religion of his fathers and taking the religion of another man. Until Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab decided that he's had enough, he picked up his sword, and he said, today I'm going to do with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So he walks and he sees one of his relatives, and the relative says to him, where are you going? Because there's a frown on the face of Umar al-Khattab. You can see that this man means business. He said, I'm going to do with the Messenger of God today, no more Islam. So this person who was his relative was also a companion. He had embraced Islam. But Islam at this time was very silent, private. People didn't know, people concealed Islam. The Sahaba were instructed to conceal the religion. He said to Umar ibn Khattab, why don't you go and sort your own family out first? That is to say, his sister and brother-in-law had already embraced Islam. This enraged Umar further. He diverted and he went to the house of his sister, Fatima, who had become a Muslimah. Was unknown to Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He knocked the door, and before he entered, he heard the recitation of the Quran. The Quran was being recited. He entered, Sayyidina Fatima opened the door, she had hid the Quran, which was on leaves at this particular time. He said, show it to me. She said, what do you want to see? Show me what you're reading. I know you've become a Muslim. What is it that you have? And he took hold of his brother-in-law and he started beating him. He's a strong man. He's a very strong man. And when he would hit you, you would feel the pain. You wouldn't hit back. He started beating his brother-in-law, and his sister tried to stop, and he slapped her, and she fell down, and she started bleeding. And when he seen that she's bleeding, she exclaimed, and she said, you could beat us as much as you like, but you won't take Islam out of our hearts. And this is the belief of his sister, speaking to her brother, who's not just her brother, is the strongest of men in this city of Mecca. A strong man, a firm man, a man that doesn't move away from his principles. But this struck Sayyidina Umar, one, her belief, and two, his sister bleeding. So he sat down, he calmed himself. And he said to his sister, I want to see what you're reading. When she realized that he's now calm, she said, not until you are pure, because nobody but the pure touches the book of Allah. So she made him wash the hands and face, and the leaves were brought forth, and he recited the Qur'an. He recited certain verses of the Qur'an. And in one of these verses, there was a verse where it says, and Allah is the creator of the universe. And as soon as he read the verse, he said, I believe Allah is the creator, and I believe Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. Accepted Islam. By merely reciting a few verses of the Qur'an, these were proficient people, people who knew the language. So he said to his brother-in-law, take me to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the least I expect from our brothers today. Let's come out of our monk states and at least say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the least, that you hear the name of the messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, and you should feel rejoiced. There should be smiles on your faces. We're talking about the messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, take me to the messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By this time, his relative who had met him on his way, he had made his way to Dar al-Arqam on the Mount of Safa. On the Mount of Safa where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was staying, and where they would meet in private and speak about Islam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would reveal the verses that have come upon him to them, the Sahaba. So Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab was taken to Dar al-Arqam, and they knocked the door. And the companion inside the home, he went to the door, and he seen Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he seen Umar with a sword. And he did not know what's happened. All he knew was that Umar is coming to assassinate the messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he reported back and said, Ya Rasulullah, Umar has come and with him is a sword. And seated next to the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was his beloved uncle, Sayyiduna Hamza, who had embraced Islam a few days earlier, a few days ago. And Sayyiduna Hamza was known for his bravery. He said, let him be and let him come. If Umar wants peace, we will be peaceful with him. And if he wants other than this, then I will blow his head off with his own sword. And that was the strength these people kept and held. So Sayyidina Umar was allowed to enter. He came and the Messenger of Allah والسلام, went to him. And the Messenger of Allah took hold of him and said, Ya Umar, what is it that you want? He said, I want to proclaim my shahada. I want to say you are the Messenger of God. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now everything else was history. From that day we know the events that took place in Mecca, how Muslims gained strength and they were able to come out in public, publicly pray in Mecca to Mukarramah. That's one incident. The other incident showing his nature was at the Hijrah, at migration. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam ordered Sahaba to migrate, and he told them to leave silently. The Quraysh found out, and they also sent out a message, and they said, whoever leaves will be killed. Whoever leaves, we will take his property. Whoever leaves will have no security. And whoever tried to leave, the Quraysh tried to stop them. They tried to stop them. When it came to the turn of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, and he was given permission to leave, he asked the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, that can I leave in public? And he was granted the permission. So Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab went to perform the tawaf of the Kaaba, and he called out to the Quraysh, the chiefs who were seated by, and he said, oh people, tomorrow I decide to leave. In noon, at noon, from a particular place, and I'm migrating to Yathrib, which later called or got named as Medina to Nabi, Medina al-Munawwar. Whoever wants for their wives to become widows and their children to become orphans, come and visit me at that place. And the next morning, afternoon, he went, he waited, and nobody turned up. In daylight, with his horse, he slowly made his way to Medina to Munawwar. Now that was the kind of person he was. That when he spoke, people knew he meant business. People wouldn't be able to stand or confront him. A man of great valor and courage. And he lived his life like this with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Battle of Badr, Uhud, and so forth, until the death of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And upon the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came the Khilafah of Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. If you're unfamiliar with the Khilafah, the Muhajirun and the Ansar gathered, and the Muhajirun said, we should have a Khalifa amongst ourselves, and you should have a Khalifa. The Ansar said to the Muhajirun. And the Muhajirun answered back, Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq specifically, he said, the Khilafah or the Khalifa must be from the Quraysh. As they heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say this explicitly, that the Khilafah will only remain in the Quraysh. It was a condition that you can't be a Khalifa unless that you are from the Quraysh tribe. The Ansar accepted. And at that time, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala and says that it was instilled into my heart that there is no one worthy of being the Khalifa except Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. And all of a sudden, he says, he came to me and he exclaimed to people that the Khilafa belongs to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and everybody accepted, and thus the bay'ah was given to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq remained Khalifa. The Khilafa for him remained for no more than 2 years or just more. In his time, there were certain issues that took place. The very first one is, how did the Muslims deal with the demise of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Keeping the Muslims together was his task. And then the fitna arose, the fitna of the people who said, we don't give zakah. So Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq led the jihad against them. So whoever differentiates between salah and zakah, he will fight them. So in these 2 years, he was indulged or occupied with stabilizing the Muslims. There were a few conquests and fighting the apostates who were from the Muslims, the Murtaddun. And then he passes away, but before he passes away, he appoints Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an as his successor, as the Khalifa. So initially when Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq was chosen, it was unanimous agreement. When it came to Umar ibn Khattab, it was one Khalifa appointing another. And nobody disagreed. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab became the Khalifa. Now I want to run with you just a quick overview of his Khilafah. He made Khalifa for 10 years. He became the Khalifa in 13 Hijri. In 14 Hijri, he took over Damascus. And that was an awesome conquest. If any of you want to actually read about chivalry, about fighting, about bravery, then read the conquest of Damascus by Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala an. But this was again under the instruction of Umar ibn Khattab. Then in the following year, in 15 Hijri, they took over Jordan. And this is where the major fight and battle took place. The Battle of Yarmouk, and more notably, the Battle of Qadisiyah with the huge Persian Empire. And the Persian Empire was brought to its knees in this battle, where the Muslims became victorious in Qadisiyah and took over Jordan. Then, following year, he took over Jerusalem, and Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab made his way to Baytul Maqdis. And that's a famous account as to how he entered Baytul Maqdis and how the people were waiting for a man of grandeur, but they found him walking and expecting him to be the one riding the camel, who was his servant, to be the Amir al-Mu'mineen. Then the following year there was a conquest. And in that following year, in 17 Hijri, there was the expansion of the masjid of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There was the drought in Arabia. This year was called the year of destruction because there was no water. This is where the Messenger, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, he gathered the Sahaba and he took hold of Sayyidina Abbas, the uncle of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he made wasila to Allah, saying, Ya Allah, by the uncle of your Messenger, give us rain. And rain came down. The following year, there were a few more conquests. In 19 Hijri, I believe, there was the conquest of Egypt. Then there was Alexandria. Then there was Nahwand. This continued until the 23rd year of Hijrah. And right at the end of the Hijrah, right at the end, the last month, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala and passed away. He left the world. These 10 years, if you have just an overview, every year he was occupied with war. He was occupied with conquests. And when a man is occupied with war and battle, he doesn't have time for other things. That's what the country, the state, the empire is occupied with. Keeping this in mind, keeping in mind that these were Arabs, people that wore sandals, keeping in mind that they did not know military warfare and strategy at war, then look at what he was able to do in his administration of these empires. And you'll be amazed if I was to start referring back between his conquest and his behavior and what we live in today. It may take up too much time, and I leave that to you, for you to think that a man who was wearing sandals, a man who would fight with not full armor, the most they would have is a coat of leather, and fighting an army with full armor, fully equipped people, and how they were able to bring down such empires. Sa'id ibn Musayyib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, one of the famous tabi'een, he narrates that in the 23rd of Hijrah, when Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he performed Hajj and returned back from Mina and came to Makkah al-Mukarramah, he said, Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab, he got off his mount and he came onto his knees and he picked up his hands and said, Ya Allah, I have grown in age. My weakness, my strength has turned into weakness, and my subjects have become too many, and I desire that you do not elongate my life. That is, you call me back. And Sa'id ibn Musayyib narrates, this dua was made in Dhul-Hijjah. This dua was made in Dhul-Hijjah. Before the end of the month, before the end of the month, he was made martyred in his own masjid. He was martyred in his own masjid. His dua was answered. You look at the dua this man is making. Allah, take me back to you. My life is enough. I've done as much as I could. I want to return back to you. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, Azza wa Jal. Now, when we look at the reasons of his conquests, the Western historians, they commentate and they say the reason as to why Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an was so successful in conquering lands was A, because the two major empires of the age, the Byzantine Empire and the Iranian Persian Empire, both of them had the heydays. They were now not at their peak. As for the Persians, since the demise or the passing away of the leader, the king Parvez, they were unable to find a successful candidate, successor, who will take forth the leadership of this empire. Within his death, or after his death, and within another 3 years, seven successors were killed. Seven people that came to the throne were killed. So there was no strength of leadership in that empire at that time. This is why the Persians fell, according to the Western historians. According to the Western historians about the Romans, they had split into their own sects of Christianity, and they were occupied with their own disputes, and thus they couldn't fight off the Muslims. Now the Muslim historians also speak, and as much as they do agree that the heydays of these empires were over, it doesn't mean that an ill-equipped people that wear sandals from the deserts can blow away such empires. Empires that were built on war. Empires that had books of war as their military manuals, like in the Romans, and that continued for a very long period of time. Empires that had a plentiful amount of weapons of war at their disposal. empires that are not invading, merely defending. That's all they were doing. They were defending. And to suggest that these Muslims were able to blow them away just because these were not stable at that time is very far-fetched. And there is a truth as to how the Muslims conquered. And a Muslim historian say that the conquests of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, they took place because the Muslim fighters, the Muslims, they showed courage, they showed valor, they showed enthusiasm, they showed bravery. It was these reasons that conquered the land. And beyond conquering, the most essential part was stabilizing the government. You can conquer, but then after a while, your conquests fall. As what happened to other conquerors like Alexandria or Alexander the Great or Genghis Khan, that they also had conquests. But as soon as their conquests fell, their governments fell down, and nobody now remembers these people that we look up to our great Alexander. But you look at the conquests of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, he conquered lands, but the people embraced Islam. The lands remained Muslim up to our age. 13 centuries have passed, and yet these people are still Muslim. And this doesn't take place when you conquer people with tyranny, when you conquer them with cruelty. When Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an went to conquer people, there were fine, clear instructions. You don't kill women, you don't kill children, you don't interfere with the aged. You only combat the men that are on the battlefield. You don't kill men because they live or they're inhabitants of that city or province or land. You don't destroy and burn trees that bear fruit. You don't poison water. You don't burn crops. You don't break places of worship. You don't mutilate people. This was direct, these were direct commands from Amir al-Mu'mineen. In difference to Alexander, for example, Genghis Khan, for example. Genghis Khan today is known as a man that was bloodthirsty, a man that was or committed ruthless butcheries of people. Alexander, when he conquered one particular area in Syria, he had 1,000 heads of the civilians placed on the city walls. He had 30,000 people, men and women, children, aged, 30,000 of them enslaved. Anybody that showed any resistance, showed bravery or fought for their independence, they were slain. Nobody was forgiven. When he took a particular land in Persia, he placed every male inhabitant to the sword. This is what these people lived on. They went to war themselves. They were there and they were leading the way and they were bloodthirsty. In difference to Umar al-Khattab, he never went to war. He was not there. Imagine now where people fighting and you don't have the leader. The leader is not there watching. But yet these people fought, these Muslims continued with such passion that was not witnessed. One of these people, or the people, the subjects of Umar ibn al-Khattab, was Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala an. When Khalid bin Walid went to war and he would speak with the leaders of the other land, the enemy, he would say to them, I bring a people, meaning his army, I bring a people that death is more dearer to them than life. I bring a people that love death more than life. They want shahada. How do you fight such people? That they want to die. They come to fight and they want to die. What brought out such people? It was iman, it was taqwa. It was the bringing up of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was the leadership of Umar ibn al-Khattab, a very meticulous man. So when you look at the conquests of Umar ibn al-Khattab and the conquests of other conquerors, there's no comparison. There's no comparison between them. Umar ibn al-Khattab, a man of justice, a man of fairness. And these are the two attributes, justice and fairness, of the Muslims that conquered that were indispensable in stabilizing the governments. This is why people remained happy being led by Muslims, in despite of them not being Muslim. We find this with the Christians and the Jews. They would pray that the Romans don't come back after the Muslims had conquered Syria. They would pray that the Romans don't come back. We're happy with the Muslims. It was such people that had such passion to have the conquests, yet they had these virtues of fairness and justice that were able to stabilize the governments, the lands and the empires to our age today. To our age today. Now when Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he started conquering, he had to now make a constitution of the state. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the Messenger of God. He was obeyed. He had revelation from Allah. No questions asked. Sayyiduna Abu Bakr Siddiq lived only for 2 years after. He had other issues to deal with. Pardon me. Yes, the Khilafah had begun in the time of Abu Bakr Siddiq, but the constitution of the state was actually placed by Umar ibn Khattab. When we look and we think, was the empire of Umar ibn Khattab, was it democratic? And I don't like to use that word. Or was it autocratic? And I don't like to use that word either. What we mean is, was the empire of Umar ibn Khattab solely upon the disposal of the Amir, Khalifa? Was it his say was final, and that was it? Or was there consultation? And we find that it was a mix of both. As Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab said, La khilafa illa an mashwara. There is no khilafa, there's no caliphate, but there must be consultation. And the very first thing Umar al-Khattab done, he made a consultative assembly. He made an assembly that he would consult with. And you have to look at this man's wisdom. He's living in a time where the empires in front of him were tyrants. They ruled, they killed. That's how people lived. There was no sense of government or decentralization. Everybody, the king, the leader, it was him and that was it. And now Umar al-Khattab, without a precedent, he is now forming an empire. And the very first thing he does is that he makes an assembly. And this assembly would decide all important matters. Do you know how this assembly was called? Whenever Umar al-Khattab had an issue, whether it was war, whether he was to appoint somebody a job, he would send out a caller, and the caller would go out, and he would name people, and he would say Amir al-Mu'mineen. You know this term, Amir al-Mu'mineen, was introduced by Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. Initially he was called Khalifatu Khalifati Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He introduced his term. The caller would call out and he would give names of people. He would say Amir al-Mu'mineen calls you to the masjid. These were people of notability, people who were well known. From the Muhajirun, the assembly was made from the Muhajirun, and the Ansar. The Ansar were made up of the two main tribes, the Aus and the Khazraj. They had five of the elite of each tribe. These were the best of people, especially Sahaba, giving preference over everybody else because of their companionship with the Messenger of God sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A man would go out, he'd call them, everybody would come to the masjid, they would gather. Sayyiduna Umar ibn Khattab would come out of the masjid, would come out and enter the masjid. He would pray two nafl, ascend the pulpit, and he would then say to the people, I have this matter and I've assembled you and troubled you and I'd like your consultation. And his words were, he would say, I want to share with you this responsibility and burden upon my shoulders. I am but a man amongst yourselves. I don't desire for you to follow me. Let's have an assembly. We'll consult. And people were free to speak. The Sahaba were very free to speak. Or anyone that was present spoke openly in front of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Making buildings is not difficult. or appointing, you may suggest, well, why did he not choose another building, which he did for many other things, as you will hear inshallah, for this assembly. The reason being was, look at the wisdom of this man. He said to himself, it may be that if we are in a closed environment, people may feel pressured by me. But if they come into the house of Allah, they will not feel no pressure. Everyone is free in the house of Allah. Let them come and speak. Let them be themselves. Sometimes the assembly was finished within minutes. Sayyiduna Umar al-Khattab would say, an army has come, we want to send an army to defend. Do we agree? Yes, we agree. This young man, I want to appoint him as a governor of a particular state. I have seen this in him, I know him such. Do we agree? Yes, we agree. Simple. Sometimes it's long. And you will see some of the examples on which they disagreed. And the Sahaba continued to discuss until a final judgment was brought. And it was the majority that ruled. Majority of this consultative assembly. Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab would not ride over this assembly. This is how he lived. Even on his deathbed, he appointed 6 people. And he said, choose amongst yourselves a Khalifa. 6 people. And let the majority go. Wherever the majority goes for, let it be that he is the one who is chosen. And the 6 people he chose are the remaining people that were alive from the companions of the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who were given the glad tidings by their name in their lifetimes that they are in Jannah. 6 people that he sat down and he said, these people have got guarantee from the Messenger of Allah that they are in Jannah, who we call Ashara Mubashara, the 10 fortunate ones. What this means is the 10 by whom or whom the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam explicitly by name said they're in Jannah. Abu Bakr fil Jannah, Umar fil Jannah. It's a famous hadith in Tirmidhi where the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned the 10 names explicitly. The 6 that remained alive, Umar al-Khattab placed them in one room and said, decide amongst yourselves. Even then there was this consultative assembly that he performed. And it was upon this consultative assembly that Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan was chosen as Amir al-Mu'mineen. Now this consultative assembly was of great importance. Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, would at times make and take decisions without consulting. He would at times take decisions without consulting. That's where we see that there were certain rights that the Khalifa possessed. So do we say that the empire was autocratic or democratic, and I'm not going to get involved in this, the word democratia, that's an issue in itself. But are we talking about the ruler rules or the people have a choice? Are we saying it's a bit of both? He, as a Khalifa, had rights and he would employ them, and he also made an assembly and he wouldn't override the assembly. And does that mean the citizens had a voice? Well, they did. They did have a voice. But not what you would say like in a democratic state, but like we have today. They did have a voice. Their voices were heard. For example, we find that when Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab, he conquered a particular land, he said to the people, the Muslim, that send to me in Medina, from amongst yourselves who you would say is the best amongst you, and most reliable and honest amongst you, that you would want him to be your leader. They would send him, and Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab would test him personally, interrogate him, and then would send him back and say, yes, you are fit to be the governor of that particular state. We look at Sa'd bin Abi Waqas. Sa'd bin Abi Waqas radiallahu ta'ala an, he's one of the 6 that was placed in the assembly, in the shura, for the people who will now choose the next Khalifa, the 6 that Sayyidina Umar left. Sa'd bin Abi Waqas is from the Ashara Mubashara. Sa'd bin Abi Waqas radiallahu ta'ala an, he was the conqueror of Qadisiyya. Remember, Qadisiyya is the most important battle, you may say, in the reign of Umar ibn Khattab, where he took down the Persians. They knelt. Now this man is of great importance. He's a conqueror. He's a leader. He's a statesman. He is a companion, esteemed companion, and he's been guaranteed Jannah. Now this one's someone amazing. al-Khattāb radiallahu ta'ala placed him as the governor of Kufa. After a while, the people of Kufa complained. They complained about his leadership. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an removed him from the leadership. You look at being just. Although he removed him, he still placed him amongst the six. And he said to the six on his deathbed that if you decide for Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas to be the leader, let him be. Don't think that I removed him from Kufa because it's unjust. It may just be that certain people need a certain leader. That's all it was. But they've complained, so I shall remove him. You know, you don't find such examples where Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an is removing a man of such esteem because people are saying we don't like him. We don't find him to be right. Other things happened in the time of Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas radiallahu ta'ala an. We find, for example, that a man once seen Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala in the masjid. He came, he was seated, discussing, and he said, "Oh Umar," by his name, "Fi Allah, Ya Umar, Fi Allah, Itaqillah, Itaqillah." Now those that were seated, he said it once, he said it twice, and he continued. One of them became angry, and they rebuked that man. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala, an Amir al-Mu'mineen, in the masjid, he stopped that man, he said, "Let him be, let him say what he wants to say." And look at the wisdom of this man. Look at the wisdom of this man, Umar ibn Khattab. He said, "If he does not exhort me, they'll become useless." Meaning if they don't feel that they can come and speak to me and say to me what they think is right and take out sometimes their frustration and give their ideas, they're going to be useless people. Give them an avenue to speak. Let them speak to me. Let them say what they want. And if I don't listen to them, I am wrong. I have wronged them. If I don't listen to them, I have wronged them. Let them be. People, when we say he was firm, yet people are able to say such things at the face of Umar al-Khattab, and he wouldn't have an issue. He wouldn't have an issue. He'd let people speak. When we talk about him being al-Faruq, we say that he's able to distinguish from good and bad. We see this throughout his life. In his empire, if people revolted, in his empire, now that he's made some conquest, if people revolted, in the time of Alexander, they'd be killed. They'd be killed before they revolt. In the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab, people are now committing treachery, for example, he would pardon them. He would say to them, the governor who is there appointed underneath him, that take and swear allegiance again, we pardon you. We know of, in his own lifetime, thrice a particular people revolted against him, and yet he pardoned them. We find an example where a particular qawm of Jews, they revolted against Umar ibn al-Khattab based on conspiracy. So Umar ibn al-Khattab exiled them. That was the most he would do. He exiled them. But although he exiled them, he paid them for their property. Look how he's treating people that are revolting against him. He's exiling them, he's not killing them, and he's paying them for their property. And he's instructing the governors of the lands that if these people happen to pass your land, you must give them the necessary assistance. And if they happen to stay in your land, do not charge them for jizya for 1 year. Don't take jizya off them for a year. These are people that have revolted against the government. And Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab is treating them with such kindness. He's able to distinguish between being right and being wrong. After speaking about the constitution that he developed, this assembly, he now started, radiallahu ta'ala an, in administration. And this is the key. This was the key of his governance, of his empire. If there is no clear administration, there is no advancement of the civilization. A good civilization needs clear departmentalization. There have to be clear departments. Otherwise, you're not able to run a land, an empire with efficiency. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was the Messenger of God. So you would come to him for everything. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, and because of his short time, he also did not divide and make departments. It's like before civilization, you would live and suffice with one room. A family would live with one room. You'd sleep in there, you'd eat in there, and you'd attend guests. But as soon as civilization advanced, you'd now have a particular separate room for sleeping in, a separate room for eating in, a separate room for meeting guests. And that's how we live now. And if we didn't advance, we'd be stuck in an age, there'd be problems. The government was the same. Initially, the Amir al-Mu'mineen, the governor of a land, he would be the officer or the leader of war at war. He'd be the military, he'd be the commander at war. So he'd be the governor, the ruler, he'd be the commander, and he'd be the judge at the same time. And that would happen in the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. He'd be the judge, and he'd be the leader, and he'd be the fighter, and so forth. And that was the same in the time of Umar al-Khattab in his early days. But as soon as the conquests began, he started dividing and made departments. And this is where his speciality comes. This is where we find him being ahead of his time. This is where we find that his conquests remained unlike any other conqueror. He was intelligent enough to divide. The very first one was dividing the whole empire. The whole empire was divided. He made provinces. As we have today, we have counties in the UK. I've come from Birmingham, it's a city, there's a certain area that it holds. It was the same in the time of Umar al-Khattab. He divided his areas. And then to each area, he sent a governor. The governor would rule that particular area. He sent the chief secretary. He appointed, this is the high posts in every province. There was a governor. Then there was a chief of secretary. There was the officer of police. There was an officer of revenue. There was an officer of treasury. There was the qadi, the judge. There was the officer that would lead the military warfare. Every individual would have his own post. Sometimes one person would occupy two posts because he had the ability. But normally speaking, he would place 8-9 posts, like I've mentioned, and 8-9 people that would hold that post. Now when these officers would become officers, he, radiallahu ta'ala, would speak to them, and he would advise every one of them, and he would say to them, remember, I'm not sending you as tyrants. I'm sending you as leaders so that people may follow you. That's what I'm sending you as, the governors, that people see you as an example. Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, he made the provinces, he made the posts, and now he needs to select the posts, select the people for the posts. And there was no one better than Umar ibn al-Khattab. He had a knack for weighing up people's characteristics, natural gift for sizing up people. He would meet them and he would know them. The difference between him and other leaders, he would know everybody. He would know his people. Personally, he would know his people. We know, for example, from his characteristics, he would walk out in the nights in Medina to see what people actually do, what they think. One of the examples is, and look at this man's wisdom. He walks, radiallahu ta'ala, an, in the night of, one of the nights in Medina, and he finds a baby crying. He finds a child weeping. So he stands at the door. There's no lights at that particular time. He stands at the door. And he carries on standing and waiting, and the child doesn't stop crying. So he knocks the door, and he says to the mother, why are you not feeding the child? And the mother, being truthful, she said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you have placed a benefit, what we today in UK call child benefit. Any of you have had children, you know what I'm talking about. Child benefit. She said, your child benefit begins when the child is weaned off, when he comes off the chest of the mother, that's 2 years of age. When the child comes off the chest of the mother, you from your revenues, the Baytul Mal, the public treasury, you give a certain fund. We are too poor. So I'm trying to wean the child off prior to 2 years. So the child was not 2 years of age, but she was trying to wean the child off so that they'll be eligible for that money. And Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, he was so upset. And he said to himself, Ya Umar, how many children you've punished? How many children? And he went back, and the very first thing he did the next morning, he abolished the benefit from 2 years to the time of birth. As soon as you have a child, you are now eligible for this benefit. So what do mothers now do? They keep him on the chest longer so that they can get more money. See, the wisdom of this man, and a lady came to him, Amir al-Mu'minin, he used to sleep in the mosque. A lady came to him. She said to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'minin, she said, mice have stopped visiting my home. What is she trying to say? I hope you guys are still awake. What is she trying to say? There's no food. She was a lady of honor. She wouldn't say, I'm hungry. She said, mice have stopped visiting her home. Umar ibn Khattab understood, and he sent 2 bags of rice and wheat to her. This is how people were able to deal with Amir al-Mu'mineen. The doors were open. He did not like porters at the door. In his time, he disliked any officer of any post to have a porter. In difference to Sayyidina Uthman and Sayyidina Ali, there was a need, because Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab was assassinated in the masjid because of this fact. He had no security guards, he had no porters. Later there was a need, but when there was no need, he wouldn't allow it. So he said to every officer, you cannot have a porter. When Sa'd bin Abi Waqas radiallahu ta'ala an was in Kufa, before he was taken away by the Kufan people, who they requested they should be removed, Sa'd bin Abi Waqas, he built a palace. Sa'd bin Abi Waqas built a palace, and in front of the palace he built a room, and the room belonged to a porter. Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab had that room burnt down in front of his eyes. And he said to him, I do not want to see a porter. You want to know the wisdom of this man, Umar al-Khattab? He ordered every officer to attend Hajj every year. Every officer in every province from all the posts would come. When they would assemble, he would speak to them, but he would also give the opportunity to any citizen to come and raise up an issue and say to Amir al-Mu'mineen, this officer of yours, whether he be the governor or he be the chief secretary, whoever he may be, he's wronged me. And Umar ibn al-Khattab would decide then and there. If he found an officer was omitting visiting the sick, wouldn't visit the sick, or the poor could not come to him, he would remove him immediately. And once he's placed them in their offices, Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu ta'ala an, he made a new department. This department was investigation of complaints regarding officers. So he made posts, he put officers in there, then he made a different post where these people will now tackle any issue or complaint that comes regarding them. Who does he place? He places the famous companion of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muhammad ibn Maslama al-Ansari. This companion from the Ansar, he would go out to war with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Once he didn't go, he was unable to go. So the Messenger of Allah left him, entrusted Medina with him. In the absence of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Umar ibn al-Khattab used this and said, if the Messenger of Allah will entrust him with Medina, I will entrust him with this post, because this post would be vital. This way you would know what people are doing. A man came to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, do you think you're going to be saved from the divine punishment of God just because you've made a few points? You've told your governors and office bearers to follow these instructions? Whilst Ayyad ibn Ghanam in Egypt, he wears fine clothes, fine shirts, and he has a porter at his door. Meaning, what benefit are your words? What benefit to your words? Are you thinking you're going to save yourself from the punishment of God? al-Khattāb dispatched Muhammad ibn Maslama immediately and said to him, go to Egypt, go to Ayyad ibn Ghanam and bring him as you find him. Bring him as you find him. He does not have chance to return home. He came, Muhammad ibn Maslama, he found a porter at the door and he found the governor, Ayyad ibn Ghanam, wearing a beautiful shirt. He was instructed, he came immediately to Medina in that shirt. When he came, Umar ibn Khattab took his shirt off and gave him wool to wear. And he said to him, you're dismissed. And now go and herd goats. Now this man, Umar ibn Khattab, was a firm, fair man. Ayyad, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he started pleading. Dare would he say no? He wouldn't say no. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I'd rather be slain to death. Give me death than me go and herd goats. Umar ibn Khattab knew people. He said, what's the issue? Your dad was a goat herd. Because that's where he got the name from, Ghanam. He was called Ayyad ibn Ghanam. He got the name Ghanam because his dad used to herd goats. He said, if your father can do it, you can do it. Go and herd goats. He kept on pleading. He kept on pleading. And he made promises until Umar ibn Khattab let him be and returned him back to his position because he was a statesman, because he had leadership skills. He broke the rule, he was pardoned. But they knew this man, Umar ibn Khattab, wouldn't let people go if there was no need. He'd only let you be if he felt that there's a greater benefit. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was another governor, a beautiful man, a beautiful Sahabi. A man complained about him. His people complained. They said, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he has 60 slaves. 60 slaves. He feeds his slave maid better than we eat food. And he has so much property. So Muhammad ibn Maslama dispatched again. Go and bring him here. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is bored. He said to him, Abu Musa, do you have 60 slaves? Muhammad ibn Maslama has now done the checking. No slaves. Do you feed your slave maid better than you feed people? They checked it, he did. He said to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, you either stop or you removed. You either stop or you removed. He didn't want to send across to people this form of lifestyle that the leaders live better than the poor people. He wouldn't allow it to happen. Even though it was allowed for a Muslim with his own wealth to have a lot of wealth. But not the office bearers of Umar ibn Khattab's empire. When the major issue that took place in his administration was when they came to the Department of Revenue of Land. Normally when you go to war, how much time do I have? How much time do I have? Say again? Half an hour? This is another department which was in some ways the most critical department for stabilizing the government. When we would normally go to war, or the Muslims would go to war, the spoils of war would be distributed by the Prophet ﷺ amongst the people that fought. The Messenger of Allah ﷺ, he did not leave any wealth in the Baytul Mal. He distributed everything in one sitting to all the people. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was the same. He would distribute everything to the people. When it came to the time of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, and the conquests became big, those that were conquering Sahaba and Tabi'un, they came back and they said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, we believe that the conquerors, meaning the people who fought, they are rightful owners of the lands and the conquered people should become their slaves. The conquered people should become their slaves. Umar ibn Khattab said, let me check. He sent his chief secretary, Abdullah ibn Arqam, to go and take a census of the people in Iraq. We're talking about Iraq, because Iraq was fully captured, the Arabian Iraq, by Umar ibn Khattab. Abdullah ibn Arqam was the chief secretary. Do you know why he was the chief secretary? Radiallahu ta'ala an. He was a Sahabi, radiallahu ta'ala an. A letter came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the letter called for a response. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, which or who amongst you can write back and write well? Abdullah ibn Arqam said, I can do so. So from his own mind, he wrote up a letter. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was very well pleased with the letter and the letter was sent out. Umar was sitting there at that time. He was seated. He remembered when he became Khalifa, he then chose him as his own personal chief secretary. You see the wisdom of this man picking up people because of their behavior with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He sent Abdullah ibn Arqam to Iraq, go and take a census of people. He checked people, the amount they were, and he found, he made a report, a very careful report, and he found that one soldier, if the population was made slaves, one soldier would have three slaves. They came back and told Amir al-Mu'mineen. Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar al-Khattab immediately called the assembly. Sayyidina Ali is there, Sayyidina Uthman is there, Abdul Rahman ibn Awf is there, Talha is there, Zubair is there. They're all seated. He said, oh my brothers, we have an issue. The issue is the following. That when Muslims go to conquer, who does the land belong to? And do the people of the land become slaves? Large number of Sahaba, like Abdul Rahman ibn Awf, they said, yes. The conquerors, they fought like you would distribute the spoils of war amongst them. They deserve to become the owners of the land. And the people deserve to become their slaves, enslaved by them. Umar al-Khattab said, I disagree. I don't think this is the best. They asked him why. And he's Amir al-Mu'mineen, but he's describing, look at intelligence. He said, if we make the conquerors the possessors of the lands, the owners of the lands, and the people, the population is enslaved, A, where are we going to get revenue to bring up new armies? Where are we going to get revenue to bring up new armies if there is an attack? Two, from where are we going to find a military? Because when you don't give nothing to people, they give nothing back to you. The people that are going to fight are going to be the population. If they're enslaved, they're going to turn against you. So Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab, he gave his opinion. Sayyidina Ali gave his own. They all kept on disputing for 3 days until Allah Ta'ala gave wisdom to the heart of Sayyidina Umar, and he found a verse where the verse suggests that those people who are made to flee from their homes and the poor, and those that will come after, they have a right in the wealth of God. The poor, we understand. Those that are made to flee, we understand. Those that will come after, they also have a right. So Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab deduced, and he said, if we make our conquerors the owners of the lands, then the ones that will come after will have no right, because the ones that are coming after will be enslaved. They'll be the children of the enslaved. And upon this evidence, the Sahaba made an ijma' and they agreed that we will now no longer allow any conqueror to take over the land. So a principle was formed by the ijma' of the Sahaba that were present at that time. A, the land that is conquered will go under capital state. The empire will hold the land. B, the people will not be enslaved. 3, the current possessors of the lands will remain the possessors, will remain the rightful owners of the lands. In difference to the Romans, when they came to Syria just before Sayyidina Umar conquered Syria, they came and they took everybody. They took the land, they took the wealth, and they enslaved people. And this was the far-sightedness of Umar ibn Khattab. Further to this, not just these, further to this, he said, Umar ibn Khattab, none of my Muslim conquerors, none of them, can A, buy land. You can't buy land. And two, you cannot engage in agriculture. And people thought he's being harsh to his own people. Be just. Okay, they won't become rightful owners by conquering, but why not? Why can't they buy? This is where we see this man being of extreme intelligence. Umar al-Khattab's idea was the following, that what made us make conquests, it was this courageousness, valor, it was this enthusiasm and passion. When people have lands to live in and take upon themselves agriculture, farming, they don't want to fight any longer. They're not going to go any further. They're going to stop. Secondly, agriculture was a particular trade that would cut you off from people. It will cut you off from people. You are yourself. Whilst tradespeople would be people that meet people and would want to move on. If their land, if they become owners of that land, they're not going to move further. They're going to stop. the farsightedness of Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, he did not allow people to buy land in the conquered lands. He did not allow them to engage in agriculture. This is an amazing man, able to see beyond the norm, able to see beyond the norm. When he took over Syria and the Romans fled, the remaining Romans, he dispossessed them. And he gave the land back to the rightful owners. That's how he divided or discussed how the land is divided. Now this is where he comes, his intelligence. As for the land that came under capital state that did not belong to people, land that came under capital state, all of its revenue was used for public utility. All of the revenue that was taken from the land was used for the land, for that people. You find other conquerors coming, destroying people. You find Umar al-Khattab coming, bringing forth civilizations amongst the people. Because his own people didn't own nothing. As for the land that was possessed by people, he started land tax, which was not done by the Prophet ﷺ and not done by Abu Bakr Siddiq, but Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab found it wise to innovate and introduce this land tax. And when he introduced this land tax, there were 86 million dirhams that came out at 1 year. And the way he distributed the land, he said, for a particular measure, let's say a square meter, depending on what the land gives the crop, he would charge a certain amount, 2 dirhams for 1 square meter, for example, of barley, and 1 dirham for sugar. If the land gave a lot of agriculture and harvest, more crops, healthy, he would charge more. If the land was more barren and didn't give much, he would charge less. Things that we see in our age today, that Umar al-Khattab was able to do this from before. When Umar al-Khattab conquered Iraq, he measured land. This was unknown to the Arabs, measuring land. He placed a Sahabi, Uthman ibn Hanif, radiallahu ta'ala, to go and measure this land. Qadi Abu Yusuf, in his book Kitab al-Kharaj, he says, this man, Uthman ibn Hanif, this companion, was able and so meticulous in measuring land that you and I can measure cloth. This is how good this man was. Umar ibn Khattab knew which man to choose for which job. He sent a Sahabi by the name of Amr Ma'adi Karam, radiallahu ta'ala an. This man was known for war, an extremely talented warrior. He sent him to this conquest of Iraq, and he sent him under Nu'man, who was the leader. And he said to Nu'man, he instructed him, let him fight, but don't be deceived, and do not give him any office, for he is nothing but a soldier. And what would happen? You would go and you would see this man fighting valiantly, and you think he deserves the office. But Umar ibn Khattab knew which person for which role. Amongst the Sahaba, the three famous Sahaba that had statesmanship in them, statesmanship, leadership, was Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an, Amr ibn al-As, and Mughira ibn Shu'bah. Umar al-Khattab gave all three of them the best governments. He gave them the best provinces. You become the leaders, because they had ambition. He knew these people are leaders. And we find this in the history and seerah of Sayyidina Muawiyah. You do not find people loving a leader more than the Syrians loved Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an, one of the best leaders and diplomatic people you would have ever seen in history. Umar al-Khattab knew. At the same time, he kept them under strict control. He didn't let them go loose. And this is what was needed to stabilize governments. People in the right places, but under surveillance. And that's why he made Muhammad bin Maslama al-Ansari the investigator. And he would take it to task. People have written that the most successful move, implementation, or innovation, you may suggest, that Umar ibn al-Khattab performed was the demolition, abolishment of oppressive, tyrannical rule system like the Romans and the Persians, the Romans in Syria. Because whenever you rule by tyranny, it falls away. We find it today. Syria is no different today. The leadership of Syria today is doing the exact same thing, ruling by tyranny. But as the empires of Alexander and Genghis Khan fell, the empires, or this empire of Syria, will also fall, inshallah, Allah Ta'ala willing, and Allah Ta'ala will give success to the believers who stand up for their rights. Who stand up for their rights. And this is where we find the example of Shaykh Muhammad al-Yaqoubi, Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, a man amongst our time, but of the age of Sayyiduna Umar al-Khattab, having far sight, knowing when to speak up. When the riots began, Sayyidina Shaykh Muhammad al-Yaqoubi on the minbar of the mosque, in front of the government, addressed them that do not harm your people, do not kill people, let not the police of Syria attack the civilians, and let there not be civilians taking up arms. Knowing what to say, when to say, is the characteristic of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab. And this is what we don't find in our age. We may find speakers like myself, but just because I've read a few books doesn't mean I can fight, doesn't mean I can administrate. Likewise with other people. Just because you may know very little about the religion doesn't mean you should not be placed in a position of honor or leadership. Because Allah Ta'ala has made people different with different skills. And I find this with Shaykh Muhammad, Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, in our sacred knowledge, if you would ever speak to brothers and look at the position certain people have been placed, it's because of their capabilities. Allah Ta'ala has given them this position because of what Shaykh Muhammad sees in these people. We don't find, you know what you call wisdom? They say wisdom is placing a thing in its place. One of the shuyukh translated wisdom and he said wisdom is the foot in the shoe. The foot in the shoe. If you place a foot of size 7 into a shoe of size 10, it's injustice. You put a foot of size 7 into a shoe of size 5, it's injustice. The wise man knows where people belong. Where people belong. This is what we don't know in our age. This is what we don't know in our age. We don't know where people should be, how they should be. Today we think that anything that you take from a disbeliever has to be wrong. Look at Umar ibn al-Khattab, he wasn't like this. Radiallahu ta'ala an. There's a hadith in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-hikmatu dalatul mu'min. Wisdom is the last property of a believer. Wherever he sees it, he finds it, he takes it. We find examples. After the revenue was made, the next most important thing that Umar ibn al-Khattab performed, and I'm going to cut it short inshallah, because this ain't going to end. Really, it's going to carry on. So I think I'd like to mention maybe a few more points that I find of importance, and I will call it a day inshallah. Allah Ta'ala give me tawfiq. One of them was justice. He made a judicial system, a judiciary, a judge. Imagine this. You have a dispute with a leader, a governor, someone of high esteem, an office bearer of a particular government. He's taking your land. So you say, okay, let's go to court. You go to court and the judge sitting there is he himself. What do you think he's going to do? I'm wrong? Of course not. For any successful civilization, you have to split the executive committee and the judiciary, and they should not be fearful of each other. And this is the superb nature and geniusness, if there's such a word, of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the Messenger of God. He's perfect in every way. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq had only 2 years, and I've explained why he was unable to do what Umar ibn